So we have reached the next module successfully. We have completed module 4 in the subject 18 ARC 6.3, Building Services 3, which deals with air conditioning, mechanical transportation and fire protection. The last two modules, which is 4 and module 5, deals with fire protection, and we have completed module 4 with our last lecture. And now it's time that we move on to the next module, module 5, subheading 1, which talks about active fire control. Remember, I told you in the last lecture, when there is fire, when we contain through passive design methods, material methods, containment strategies, evacuation strategies, that is passive fire protection, when we have to put additional efforts, human intervention to stop a fire, to contain a fire, to put off a fire, to extinguish a fire, that is active fire control mechanism. This is clear. Now, no wasting time further, let's get into the concepts. So this lecture, usually in the last two lectures I have divided them into three. This lecture we will try to divide it into four, so that I'm not saying all of them will be 20 minutes long, maximum of 20 minutes, but we will still try to break it into four parts, okay, to make it easier for understanding. So one is concepts and active fire control. Next, fire alarm system. Third is fire suppression system. Suppression system alone I have categorized into part 1 and part 2. This clear? We are going to make it very easy and interesting for us. Next slide. Yeah. So part 1, our 20 minutes starts now, is going to have introduced concepts in active fire protection or control. So before we get in, we should remind ourselves the fire triangle. Remember, I hope you remember, not even very long, just a lecture back, two lectures back, I spent so much time in discussing fire triangle. Remember, if you still say no, remember that exercise where we try to identify the elements from a fire triangle from a stone age. If you still say no, remember that example where I left you unanswered with the forest fire, trying to identify the fire triangle elements. Still say no, please go back, watch that video and come back. Alright, okay. So to know active fire protection concepts, remind this to yourself, fire triangle or fire tetrahedron. In that lecture, again, if you remember, I told you putting fire off means we have to cut off either of these three, the heat, the fuel or oxygen. The moment we cut anything off, the fire will automatically get extinguished. So this concept is the one which you're going to rely on completely when we talk about active fire protection methods. Okay. Right. So remember the materials. I don't think I need to remind you. The fuel, which is a combustible material, oxygen, and the fuel. Sorry, the heat. I think. Zulta, the heat. Sorry. Right. Okay. So there's a slight mistake here. So this has to be heat. Right. Sorry about this. So we are going to cut off any three of these ingredients so that we can stop the fire. Right. This we know, fire triangle. Right. So what we don't know is, we know that we are going to cut off some of these ingredients, take some of these ingredients out to put off the fire. What we don't know and what we should know is, when we say to extinguish fire with additional manual efforts, our intervention is to remove any of these four, right? The first one is cooling, which means the heat have to be removed. How do you remove the heat? You have to cool. This is clear, right? So when we attack this triangle, approach this triangle from this side, the heating side of it, when you're going to take that off, this is going to be called as cooling, right? The next one is smothering. Smothering means, again, the triangle, we are not going to touch the heat in the fuel part. We are going to cut off the oxygen supply by doing something to this entire fire process so that further oxygen or let's say oxidation will not happen to this particular fire. When we cut that oxygen side of the fire triangle, that is going to be called as smothering. All this is again from Indian standards, so please pay attention. It's interesting to know some of these definitions so that we can keep up with the conversation when we get into such conversation. Rather than just talking a fire, we should be able to tell what in fire are we talking, right? The next one, when removal of fire, so we took heat part of the triangle, we took oxygen part of the triangle, when we are going to take the fuel part of the fire triangle, that is called as starvation, right? So cooling, smothering, starvation. But we also know that there is a chemical reaction which takes place rapidly, right? So interrupting the chemical reactions in the flame is called as inhibition, right? So is it clear? Cooling, smothering, starvation, inhibition. With this, we have attended to not just the fire triangle, but also the fire tetrahedron. Again, from the IS standards. Clear? I'm moving on to the next slide. Again, so let us extend our understanding. To extinguish the fire is to what? First, we have to identify, detect that there is a fire. Okay. Then there is a fire, then we have to alert everybody. Saying there is a fire before it spreads, please find yourself in a safe place, right? While we are doing that, it is also important to extinguish the fire. So this, let's say this is a process. Detect, alert everybody, then extinguish. So that we are at minimum loss of lives and materials. Okay, so the first part, just because this part has, this session has four parts, the first part is over so soon. We'll take a quick break before we move on to the next part. I hope we have recovered from the quick break. The next part of this lecture series is fire alarm system. Remember in the previous part I told you, first is to detect, then alert, then extinguish. So this detection mechanism, detection systems is what is going to be discussed about in this particular part of this lecture, which I'm going to put it under a name called fire alarm system, also called as FAS popularly. Okay, now we have to detect the fire and alert people, alert the users. There are two systems, two ways we can understand this FAS fire alarm system. One is the detection mechanisms, systems. Next is the alarm systems. After detecting, if it knows the information that there is a fire and nobody is communicating to anybody, there's no point in detecting. So these two work together. When somebody detects, the next action that they have to do or perform is alert, which is alarm. So usually it is alarm through, say, auditory means, before we witness a fire through our visual senses. Okay, what is fire alarm system? A system to alert us in an emergency fire situation. We have two ways of doing it, detect and alert, which is alarm system. So together this is called as fire alarm system. Fine. When you say detect, how do you detect? How do you know that there is fire? Who is going to detect that there is fire? So this becomes important. There are several ways of detecting fire. So the one which is listed is heat detectors, smoke detectors, carbon monoxide detectors, multi-sensor detectors, manual call points. You know what? We understand all these are going to be detectors. Some of you or most of you must have seen a detector also, right? A small round thing with LED blinking stuck to the false ceiling or the soffit ceiling, that is detector. With the wire coming in, that is detector. And that is why they say even in the aircraft, no smoking in the lavatory. Why? No smoking in the toilets. Why? It detects and it creates false alarm, right? So rather than me putting all the images of these detectors here, I'll give you a quick exercise. Spend a couple of minutes, precisely 2 minutes or less than that. Search for all these detectors: heat detectors, smoke detectors, carbon monoxide detectors, multi-sensor detectors, manual call points. Search all this and see it for yourself. How do they even look? Maybe you'll be surprised to see, sir, all of them look the same. There's no difference. What is happening inside those detectors is there will be a detection mechanism. Some of them are designed to detect heat. When do they detect heat? When there is temperature differences between the sensors, that is when they detect that there is a heat. I have to alert. When these two detector sensors sense that there is some obstruction, which is smoke, that is when, so they say ionization. There are several types of smoke detectors. One uses the concept of ionization, second light scanning, third light obscuring. One quick example I would want to give you is, if you have carefully observed, even if you have not observed in the cinema halls, next time you go, if you look at it, if you happen to sit in the opposite end of the screen from the far, you will see a couple of, let's say, this big device on one side of the wall attached facing the other side, and precisely right opposite to that will be another device. So what they are actually doing is they're emitting radiation and one person is receiving the radiation. So whenever this radiation is not clear and obstructed with some form of smoke, that is when they quickly alert the system. So of course they use IR radiation, infrared radiation. So if I'm not sure, it is anyways worth it to just observe what's happening in the ceiling next time you visit a cinema hall. Keep it in mind. So smoke detectors, several ways to detect smoke called smoke detectors, even though it is going to look the very same like a heat detector. Carbon monoxide detectors senses the presence of carbon monoxide in the ambience, right? Multi-sensor detectors can probably have a couple of them, a sensor to make sure that smoke is not the only cause. Probably it can combine one carbon monoxide detectors, one smoke detector, one infrared barrier. If all three conditions are satisfied, only then it will send a signal and alert the entire system. So all these are detectors. There's something called manual call point. Manual call point, MCP. MCPs, not heard, not seen. You're wrong. You must have definitely seen the red color box, which is fitted at, let's say, this level. If I'm not wrong, it is at 900 or 1200 mm from the floor level. Red color dot with a box with a breakable glass with a button inside. When there is a fire that is happening in front of your eyes in a building, in a built space where it is not expected at all, and you see none of the detectors which is present is detected it yet, or there is no detectors at all in that space, you can't just run away. You have a possibility of reaching to the nearest manual call points attached to your wall, break the glass, press the button. All these detectors, once when they detect the fire and sense information, you're going to manually send information. In other words, activate the same system manually. This is MCP's manual call point. Again, don't forget, after this break, spend a couple of minutes to do a quick search of all these items so that you understand how they look, at least to look how they are, so that next time when you go to different buildings, you will find out what is what. Word of caution, don't mistake cell phone tower coverage boosters for a detector. They also probably look the same. Just because you're searching all this, it is also a good idea to search for network boosters, which looks almost like this, but they have nothing to do with fire detector or fire alarm system, right? I trust you, you'll do the search. I'll move on to the alarm systems. Okay, somebody's detected the fire now. We trust the detector is in place, or even the person who is working, the manual call point is pressed, somebody has detected the fire and the system is alerted. How do we alert? As in the panel has received that there is fire. Now, how you have the information that there is fire, how do you alert it? How do you alert people? How do you pass on the information to the people? That is your alarm systems, right? So there are several ways in which these alarms can be conveyed. There are four ways, as you can see. One is conventional connections, conventional, this conventional, we'll see what it is. Addressable systems, okay. Intelligent systems, okay. Wireless systems, as the name implies, the systems must be wireless. We will try to understand what each of this is. The box that I have put here is nothing but a panel, fire alarm panel. Maybe some of us have not seen it yet. I will show it to you by the end of the lecture, but try to imagine that there is a panel. There is a panel of this size fixed onto the wall with a door with so many LEDs blinking inside. Am I giving you some kind of a picture, vague picture? More than enough. There's a box which is going to have detectors, which is going to have this panel. The panel itself is a panel and the alarms, right? Conventional systems, conventional connections, you have these detectors all over. You will put wire to each of them. You will connect it, bring it to the panel. From the panel, you again connect to the hooters, sirens, alarms, all this. So they detect, pass the signal to the panel. Panel is going to say the hooter, all these alarms. You start your alert in terms of the sound or flashing lights and all that, right? So conventional ways of connection, electrical conducting, very similar to that, right? Conventional ways of doing things, right? So this is going to be, all this is going to be in the panel. Detectors, the panel. Panel is going to be the command center. Takes information from the detectors, processes it, passes to the alarm system, that is conventional system. Now, there is something called addressable system. The difference is that there are 10 floors and there is only one detector which is sensed something is wrong, and that is telling to the panel, look, there is fire. So instead of asking the entire building without knowing where the fire is, saying all of you please evacuate yourself, reach to the safe place, unnecessary panic. So what this does is, it will say if it is detector number 1 or detector number 2 or detector number 101 or detector number n, which is the one which created, which picked up, which detected the signal that there is fire. So in the panel, we will know who created the alert. Accordingly, we can send the nearest personnel, security personnel in that floor. Let's say floor number 112, there is fire, and one detector in 112th floor has picked up fire. I am not going to ask everybody to evacuate. I will send somebody to check or look through my CCTV building management system to see if there is real fire surrounding that detectors. If there is a fire, people would have automatically started running by now. I will guide them. If it's a false alarm, keep quiet, attend to the detector so that we don't create further false alarms unnecessarily. So this panel which sits here, panel, remember the one box which is fixed to the wall with so many LEDs blinking inside, which is attached to the wall, is corresponding to the call address from the detectors. Then if it is true, then it passes that alarm to sound, which is again in floor number 112th, right? 12th, somewhere in that detector, where in the place of that detector, saying all of you please rush, right? This is addressable. So instead of saying everybody to get out, evacuate, I'm going to say that there is fire in this zone, only people from that zone can come out. Next is intelligent systems. Okay, so now what is becoming intelligent? Not all of them, the detectors, panel and the alarm is not going to be intelligent. Only the detectors are going to be intelligent. What do you mean by intelligent? They become intelligent in terms of they pick up the signal. Instead of sending it to the panel to process, they only process. They make sure that the information is processed, then they send it to the panel. The panel's workload is reduced because the detectors are intelligent. They solved it. Half of the case is solved there only. Panel receives whatever is left out to process, they process, gets to the alarm, alarm sounds. This is intelligent systems. And wireless system. We all are very familiar with the wireless mechanisms and systems these days, where there is no wire at all, no conventional connections. Detector, wireless. Panel, wireless. Alarms, wireless. Everybody is wireless. Everybody is doing their job. Hopefully, efficiently they are doing the job. So, entire process is happening, same process, without any wire. This is wireless system. Before I say end of the session, because we have crossed 20 minutes, I guess, this is what I spoke to you about fire panel. The box fitted on the wall with so many LEDs blinking inside. So you also have a phone caller which connects to the nearby fire station. There are so many lights here. All of them are connected to several panels and several detectors. This also has options to trigger false alarm for mock drill purposes. Also has ways to neutralize false alarms. So rightly called as the control panel. This is the fire control panel. Takes information from the detectors, processes, sends it to the alarm systems, and also act as the major control panel, usually located in the BMS, building management system cell, or with dedicated personnel attending to the fire control panel. With this, we're done with part 2. The first part was literally very short. This one is relatively okay. We've not crossed 20 minutes. It's okay. So the next two parts, we'll be talking about fire suppression system. As a recap, we are dealing with active fire control or protection systems. We started with detection and alarm. These two are done. Clear? We should move on to the next, where we are going to extinguish the fire. Coming up, fire extinguishers, extinguishing the fire in the next two parts. Break. Welcome back to part 3. Quickly recover from the break. Part 1 and part 2, we had dealt with active fire protection techniques, majorly on fire detection and fire alarm systems. Now that the fire is detected and the alarm is sounded, alarm went off, it is important to know how can we suppress or extinguish fire. So that takes us to this part. Fire suppression systems, usually it's majorly the sprinkler systems, but also when there are fire extinguishers, that is put as a requirement in many of the codes. So we also will quickly go through what fire extinguishers are about and how they are classified. Going back to the very first lecture in terms of the classification of fire that we had studied, we understood class A, class B, class C, class D type of fires, based on the material, the combustible material which contributes towards the fire. And the extinguishers, when we talk about extinguishers, it is about which material is going to put off or extinguish. First, we will study about the fire extinguishers and then come to the sprinkler systems. Okay. So, the next slide, fire extinguishers. Of course, active fire protection strategy or device used to extinguish or control small fires, often in emergency situations. Active fire protection device. The problem is, this is only for smaller fires. We can't fight a huge disastrous fire across all the buildings with each of us standing with a fire extinguisher and trying to extinguish. So, not a very practical solution. So, this is the point to be understood here is control relatively small fires. So, okay. So there are types of these water extinguishers, sorry, fire extinguishers. We must have seen, next time when you see a fire extinguisher lying on the floor or put in a vehicle, your car, bus, wherever you see, it'll always have a square or a circle written and it's saying A or B or C or D. Pay attention to it. But yeah, we will try to see what the types of fire extinguishers are. One is water-based, foam-based, powder-based, carbon dioxide-based, wet chemical-based. You remember the types of fire, classifications of fire, A, B, C, D. Anybody remembers? Don't look at the bottom of the slide. Try to remember, try to recollect. Yeah, no? Anyways, it is listed down here. Class A, solid combustible materials. B, flammable liquids. C, gases. D, metals. Then we go to UK standards. It is electrical fires and cooking fires. This said and done, classification of fire. Again, remember this. I've reminded you anyways. Okay, so now the classification of fire on one side, the fire extinguisher types on the other side. Can we try to figure out, match the types of fire and the method used to extinguish those types of fire? The first one I told you is water-based. What does it do? Takes away the heat. What is it called? When we attack, when you approach the fire triangle, taking the heat part away, what is it called? Remember? Cooling. Okay. So this is used for class A and B fires. Foam again attacks the heat part of it. What is it called? Cooling. Class A and B fires. Fine. Powder type interrupts a chemical reaction. What is it called when we stop the, when we interrupt the chemical reaction? Anybody, can you guess? Inhibition. Correct. So this, just because we are stopping the chemical reaction itself, it can cover three types of fire, class A, B and C fires. Carbon dioxide based takes away the oxygen element. What is it called when you take away the oxygen element in the fire triangle? It is called as what? Starvation? No, it is called as smothering. Taking the heat is called cooling. Taking the oxygen out is called smothering. Taking the what? Fuel is called, heat is called cooling. Oxygen is called smothering. Fuel is called starvation, right? And the chemical reaction interruption is called as inhibition. And the final wet chemical, it also takes away the heat factor, which is for the cooking fires, class F fires, right? Fire extinguishers, understood. All of them have different color codes and different standards, and they have this labeling written whether they are which type of fire. Most of us, it is so sad, including me, that every time I try to feed in this information of, okay, class A, water-based, when I see water-based fire extinguisher, I remind myself that is for class A fires. Just because we don't face the situation on an everyday basis, I keep forgetting it. So it would be a nice idea to figure out a way that we feed these informations inside our brain, that we are prepared for the negative situations, right? So make sure you understand what is water-based extinguishers for, what is foam-based extinguishers for, what is powder-based extinguishers for, what is CO2-based extinguishers for, what is wet chemical based extinguishers are for. Don't stop there. Also understand how to use an extinguisher. Watch out videos. Observe extinguishers whenever you see. Of course, don't blame me saying, sir, you wanted me to understand and learn how to use an extinguisher. I thought I'll just open it and see how it works. Don't do it. Make sure you learn, understand, have a knowledge of how to use it. And it should come to your help and rescue when it is needed. End of part 3 stops here. That means the next part that we are going to see is going to be of sprinkler systems. And also, I'll attach something to the in the end of the next part, which is firefighting systems as well. Right? Break. And the last part of this lecture is here. Continuing the fire suppression systems, we studied fire extinguishers in the last part. Here we will talk about fire sprinkler systems. Again, this is an active fire protection strategy consisting of a water supply system providing adequate pressure and flow rate to a water distribution piping system onto which fire sprinklers are connected. So an active fire protection method consisting of water supply, adequate pressure, flow rate of water distribution piping system to which something called a sprinkler is connected. A rewind to my first lecture where I told you about the ego equation in services. These guys are all connected, closely connected to each other, just that we don't realize the importance of how closely they have to function, and that is why they have their own ego, but they all require each other to function properly to make the system as a whole as an efficient system, right? So the fire sprinkler, you talk about fire sprinkler, you're talking about a pipe, an active pipe, water supply system with the right pressure and flow rate to which the sprinklers is connected. Right, this is a sprinkler system largely relying on the plumbing water supply system. Remember this. Okay, so what you see in front of you is the different types of sprinkler, because the previous slide we spoke about the importance of flow rate, adequate pressure and all that. We have pipe with adequate pressure, flow rate and all that, and to the end of it is what we have connected, something called as a sprinkler. This, the pipe comes like this, the adequate supply and all that is here under each of this, right, filled with water. So this is conventional, where you have water actually flows like this and it gets distributed like this. Okay, and this is conventional upright. Okay, so imagine this to be ulta. So a conventional sprinkler is going to be like this. Okay, upright is basically upright, it is going to be facing upwards. The idea is something called a structural cooling. What is a structural cooling? We need to cool the structure, because once again, go back to my previous lecture, it is important to protect the structural elements from fire. They have to be resistant to fire, because once when the structure collapses, the entire building collapses. And especially the upright sprinklers are used in, you next time when you go to a parking lot in an apartment or a multiplex or a mall, you will see this upright sprinkler standing like this. So you have the ceiling here, there will be some distance here, and these sprinklers will be facing upwards. The idea is, imagine you saved all the buildings, but the basement is constantly getting heated up. What happens is the basement becomes weak, building collapses. No point in protecting the remaining building. So this is when upright sprinkler comes into existence. It constantly cools the structure. This is the ceiling soffit. It keeps throwing water here, so that this is getting cool. Very simple, intelligent idea based on common sense. If it is, all the heat and smoke usually gets accumulated and they travel upwards, they get accumulated here. When I'm constantly throwing water here, I'm constantly bringing the temperature of the ceiling soffit down, thereby keeping the entire building, the floor slab and the entire building safe. A pendant, whatever we use normally, is a pendant sprinkler. Horizontal side wall. Remember, again, your cinema halls, you can't hang a sprinkler all the way from a 20 meter, 8 meter high ceiling just to save you. In such cases, what they do is they put horizontal side wall sprinklers, vertical side wall sprinklers. And so that basically the idea of a sprinkler is to put up the fire with the use of water, pressurized plumbing, water supply system. The sprinklers are not going to function if there is no water in the pipe at all. Remember this. Okay. Horizontal sidewall, vertical sidewall, all said and done. There is something called recessed pendant. If you say, I'm an architect, I don't want to see a pendant, I don't want to see a sprinkler. There are sprinkler recessed types of recessed pendants, types of concealed horizontal sidewall. All that you're going to see is just this white plate. You have options. Similarly, white plate as the for the concealed pendant for the false ceiling, right? Okay, if you've noticed or not noticed, one thing that keeps changing here is the color here. There is some green color here, there is some red color here, there is some other color here, there is again a red color here. Do they mean anything to us? Two guesses. All those who think it is going to mean something to us, raise your hands. I can't see. So all those you think who think it's not going to make any difference to us, raise your hands. Again, I can't see. Figure it out for yourself. Yes, the bulbs which are there is going to make a difference. The material, the liquid which is going to be filled in this portion, which is called as the bulb, sprinkler bulbs, is going to have different boiling points, different flash points, right? At a particular temperature, let's take this first example. 141 degrees Celsius is what is needed for that blue liquid. I'm not telling which liquid is what, which color is which liquid. 2 minutes after this break, after the session, you're going to figure out sprinkler bulbs and their meanings. Please type it out on Google. It is going to tell you what is the filling material that is inside these bulbs and what is their flashpoint boiling temperature. So the first one, if you take the blue color, which is right here, right, blue color is going to expand at 141 degrees Celsius when this is fixed onto the ceiling and there is constant heat and smoke and fire. Where it feels it has reached 141 degrees Celsius, it is going to expand. When it is expand, this is a thin flimsy glass material. Once when this material wants to expand, it can't of course go inside the water supply system because it is already pressurized, precisely pressurized. So it has to expand, so it breaks. When it breaks, that is when water flows. So when this expands, it has to go out in all directions, so it breaks. So what happens is water rushes like this and it goes in all directions. This is the idea of a sprinkler. So why we discussed about sprinkler bulbs is because of their temperature. So this is 141, this is 93, this is 79, this is 68, and this is 57. So depending upon the usage, or how you anticipate or go back to the classification of building, remember A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, J, residential, educational, institutional, and so many other classifications. Depending upon the functions that is going to happen in a particular space, a designated purpose, we can choose our sprinklers in such a fashion that there's no point in putting 141 degree Celsius sprinkler in a place where you're going to constantly cook, because there's going to be constant heat. That's a regular activity which normally is going to send out heat and fumes, which is 50 degrees Celsius. It will keep on breaking every now and then. So the idea is, depending upon the function that we're going to, that a space is going to house, from that you have to choose your sprinkler bulbs accordingly. Of course, we have standards for all this. Knowing this, okay, I told you the water supply system have to be pressurized, precisely pressurized, neatly maintained, etc., etc., etc. But before we get in there, there are again differences here. There are again types here. Let's try to understand what a wet pipe system is. The heat activates the nearest sprinkler head, releasing pressurized water stored in the pipes. Heat activates the nearest sprinkler head, the bulb, right? and water gets released. Simple. That's all we've been discussing all this while. What we didn't discuss, what is going to be a bit contradictory or contrasting, is this. The pipes are filled with pressurized, not water, but air. The pipes are going to be filled with, if we have understood all this while, the entire theory we said, water is there waiting to enter. Dry pipe system only, there's no water in the system. It is going to be filled with air or nitrogen, which will be released first if a fire activates the valves in the sprinkler head, right? The pipes then fill with water and discharge it over the smokes and flames. So pipes, when they directly the sprinkler head breaks and water comes in, wet pipe system fully loaded at all possible times, the entire plumbing system waiting to extinguish fire based on the instructions from a sprinkler head, wet pipe system. Pipe is not loaded with water, pipe is loaded with air, but upon instruction that air is going to release first and then it is going to make way for the water. That is nothing but the dry pipe system, right? So the pipe that we've been talking about is what? Nothing but the red pipes that you see hanging from your ceiling in all possible exposed floors in a commercial establishment or under the false ceiling, above the false ceiling, which we usually can't see. That is why the best way to observe this is next time you go to a shopping mall, watch out in your basement when you park your bike or car for these red color pipes hanging from the ceiling through a hanger. Nothing but sprinkler pipes. You can also see the upright sprinkler also attached to them, which I'm going to show you in the next slide. Here, the next slide. So this is a pipe that we've been talking about, loaded with water in a wet pipe system, loaded with air or nitrogen in the dry pipe system, made to hang from several supports at regular intervals from the ceiling. And I told you, you can find upright sprinklers also trying to cool the structure, called as the structural healing. Structural cooling. So this is what I've been talking about. Keep your eyes open. Look out for these. Observe if you find it anywhere. Watch out for the sprinkler heads. Watch out for the red color bulb sprinkler heads. Find out which material is that, what is the boiling point of it, the flash point of it, at which it expands. Also find the diameter of the pipe changing. The main pipe is obviously going to be of bigger diameter. As it branches out, is going to narrow down, right? Okay, two more. Pre-action system. So we spoke about wet pipe system, we spoke about dry pipe system, pipe system. There are two more. One is pre-action system and one is deluge system. Okay, so this is more like, am I increasing the complexity in the pipe? Sir, loaded with water all the time, why are you complicating it? Kind of a feeling. Is it there? Nevertheless, we'll understand it and probably then try to get into this discussion. The pre-action system require a two-step verification. When there is a detection, the pre-action valve will open and allow water into the pipes. Water has come. Then the sprinkler heads can be individually activated to release the water over the fire. This two-step process enables facilities to shut off the system in case of false alarm, protecting their assets from water damage. We get information, detection and alarm, but we first, the air allows the water to come in, and then we decide if there is a real fire or not. Should I really release the water and then release? Complicated? Let's not use the word complicated. It is sophisticated, because till now we've been talking about fire in the basement where we're going to park some cars or say bikes, vehicles. So imagine you have to go for this particular system. where you have a relatively bigger asset. Let's say you have a server room, you have the server, but if there's a false alarm and the water is going to flow all over, sprinkle all over the server and data systems, it is going to cost so much, can't afford. So that is when we check, okay, there's a fire alarm, detection alarm, then the signal from the sprinkler, should I open it or not, depending upon the genuineness and the severity of the fire, then we open it. This is why we have a two-step verification before we activate the system. This is pre-action system, not complicated, sophisticated, let's say. Deluge system, let's read it out. The sprinkler heads in the system are always open. No need to worry, they are open always. No heat sensing element, the bulb, that color thing is not even there, forget it. No heat sensing element in the sprinkler head system itself and required. And they don't need any external smoke to activate. The moment the heat is detected, water happily fills the pipes and released to open in all the sprinkler heads, creating a flooding effect across the entire area. Means, so in the previous pre-action system, we were conservative because we care for the appliances, the equipment which is placed under the sprinkler. Whereas the deluge system, I have to put the fire off at any cost. Even if it means that I have to flood the entire area, I am ready to do it. No stopping me, there's no time to check whether it is happening, is it true, all that. I'm going to flood it. So four types: wet pipe, water is loaded, detection, flows. Dry pipe, air is there, detects, air allows water to flow, flows. Pre-action, two-step activation, sophisticated to save the equipments, safe. Deluge system, flooded all across, no bulb, no nothing, always water is ready to flow, all across, safe. Four types of sprinkler activation mechanism or systems. Okay, I told you, I'll also talk about firefighting systems. This lecture perhaps may be a bit longer than 20 minutes. I don't think you would mind. It's okay, we will complete it off. Firefighting systems again. I told you about a movie called Towering Inferno. You should definitely try to find some time and watch. There again, like how we studied in our sprinkler in terms of wet and dry, there are two types. Wet, riser system. Dry, riser system. Go back, rewind to your electrical services. Do you remember a terminology called rising mains? Okay. Rising mains? Yes, no. Heard about it and forgot. Forget it. So we have firefighting systems where the fire brigade is going to come in. There's a driveway, there's a fire driveway. Remember the setbacks and all that we talk about from our codes, the bylaws. We talk about all that. What does it mean? They say leave some setbacks on all sides. So there are several bylaws depending upon the cities. It says you have to maintain this much of a distance for a fire brigade to come, take turn, stand. And there is a separate distance from the building block so that they can aim at the fire and to extinguish the fire. So we have a system to take care of that, where the firemen come in and they are equipped enough to start fighting the fire. So there's two systems. One is the wet riser system and the next one is the dry riser system. I would leave you to guess this. What is a wet riser and what is a dry riser? Of course, we know it's a riser system. It's going to be completely for high rise structures, right? Of course, the next subheading in the module wants us to know more about the high riser systems. Fire safety requirements for high rise buildings. We will get there eventually, but what is it? What is the dry rice system and what is the wet rice system? Guess we are going to have some kind of risers all across the building. And this has to be, sometimes it is going to be wet and sometimes it is going to be dry. Simple. I'll take you to the next slide. Makes it very clear when this is a dry riser. I am cutting this off. This has an inlet to the pipe and a valve at every floor, which is not at all loaded at any point of time when there is no fire. When there is a fire and after the fire brigade comes in, when it gets connected to this breaching inlet, this gets loaded, and whichever floor the fire is in or to be extinguished, that is where this is opened, the landing valve is opened and used to extinguish the fire. This is what type? Dry type, for obvious reasons that this pipe is not loaded. So when this is dry rice, you must have guessed what wet rice is, correct? So wet rice is, there are water tanks which constantly feeds these pumps and the entire line is already connected. So there is no necessity of a fire brigade to come and stand here and feed the system. It's already fed, right? I just have to go as a fireman, I have to reach a particular floor and connect my hose reels into it and start fighting the fire. What do you think is the advantage in a dry firefighting system and in a wet firefighting system? Any guesses, anybody? 2 minutes. When I say 2 minutes, it's not going to be 2 minutes, okay? Okay. One is not loaded. I'm getting water from my fire brigade and connecting. Why? Question this. Keep this question. Remember this. Next, the water tanks are already filled. They're always loaded. So, the image of water tank is shown in the bottom. But you know how our water tanks work? We always put it in the top. And in case of fire, in case of electrical equipment failure, and if the water tanks are not able to pump it till here, or some are not able to pump the water till here because there is an electricity failure, we can't expect the system to be loaded always. Some of this pipe, let's say, is getting cut and all that. So, looking at this possibility, we feel okay, dry is relatively safer because water supply is going to be there. And this is going to be intact, relatively better. And another problem is, as in not a problem, a smart way, or in fact it's there in the standards, when you're pumping it, you should always pump it to the fire tank before the domestic tank. So to make sure the fire tank is always full, what we do is we first pump into this tank. When this is filled, it overflows into the domestic use or the portable or regular use, water use. So that we make sure the fire connection is always full, okay? So this fire tank is called a static water storage tanks. They are always kept full and so that we are prepared at the time of a fire. So both of them have their own advantages and disadvantages, but yes, it depends upon the situation, the type of fire that we are talking about and the extent of damage it is going to create, right? So with this, I think we have completed module 4 completely and module 5, the first subhead. We will quickly have a look at the syllabus in terms of what we have done till now. So this is the syllabus. So it is time that we take a quick recap because we have only one subheading left under these two modules. I'll start with, in fact, we'll go from 9. Okay. So we studied about basic concepts in firefighting installation, the concept behind fire fighting installations. We started with a detection system, alarm system, and then firefighting. We studied sprinklers, automatic fire detection and alarm system. Yes, fire hydrants are the ones which is used to connect for the fireman to connect and fight the fire. So in an event of fire inside the building. And we studied about concepts in pacifier protection in buildings, escape routes, driveways, refuge areas, assembly areas, pressurization, travel distance, fire tower, compartmentation, fire signages. I've briefly covered. Yes. And we started with classification of fire hazards and causes, grading of structural elements, building types classification, characteristic of combustible, non-combustible material. So all this is covered. What is left in the next lesson? Next session is 10, which is NBC requirements of fire safety, rules for fire protection and firefighting requirements for high-rise buildings in India. With that, we will complete this entire subject. And that's about it. See you in the next lecture. Thank you.